Greetings and welcome to another devotional series. We're working from the overall theme of the Savior's sermons, and today his sermon would be, "You are, so be. You are the salt of the earth, so be it. You are the light of the world, so be it." And in the context of this message from Matthew chapter 5, from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, I'm going to talk about how you can be these things because of what's behind me. The Lord is our righteousness. Let's begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. The name of our Lord, worthy of all alleluias, without end. For sending His light into the world, dear friends. The professional athlete, after sitting out a whole season with an injury, is back working out with his team. When asked if he's ready to get back into games, he replies, "I'm not there yet, but I'm close. I'll get it right soon." The presentation for work has taken months to complete. You ask your project manager if your team is going to make next week's deadline. "We're not ready yet, but we'll get it right by then." Your driving test is coming up. You've spent the obligatory hours driving around with mom and dad. Your parents can tell that you're nervous, and so they ask if they can help. But you respond by saying, "I'm okay, but I know I got to study some more so I can get it right when the time comes." You're talking to a friend and you find a way to get to turn the conversation toward church. "To be honest," she says, "I keep trying to live a better life, but I only feel like I'm failing. I just don't think I'll ever get right with God." Now, we have no problem with a rehabbing athlete or project manager at work or a student driver in training working toward getting it right. But it should bother us to hear of anyone who is still struggling with the belief that they have to somehow get right with God. That's because this status with God that they're chasing after is something that they already have because of Jesus. He made all of mankind right with God when He exchanged His righteousness for our sins on the cross. So now it's our mission to let others in on what we already know, that they already are right with God. As His children, we can accomplish our mission only when we reflect that righteousness, the righteousness won for us by our Savior. It's because of Him that you and I cherish the fact and the blessing of being right with God. I want to talk about righteousness today. Righteousness demanded, fulfilled, and finally, righteousness that is now ours to share. A portion of God's word before us this morning is another section of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, as I mentioned. I want you to keep in mind, Jesus is not just speaking to everyone here. He's not just giving out general rules for the entire world to live by. He's specifically talking to believers who already knew the way to heaven was through faith in Him. His words now were meant to guide believers in how they could show their love and appreciation to God for all that He had done for them. It's a way for them to excel in their lives of what we call sanctification, of setting their lives apart for a God who had done so much for them. I want to turn to the latter portion of Matthew chapter 5 of our text, where we find Jesus reminding his followers of their own inability to achieve righteousness, of being right with God by themselves. And verse 18, pick it up there. Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished." You know, when people look at God's law, they can see that there's no way to live up to God's expectations. Later on, Jesus clarifies this in his sermon. He identifies those expectations in even simpler terms. He says, "Be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect." Now, perfect obedience is demanded of us in order to be saved. And we dare not try to soften God's law. Jesus says we can't even alter the smallest letter of that law. That is, the smallest Greek letter, the iota, which we use in the phrase, it doesn't make one iota of a difference. We can't even mess with the least stroke of a pen, Jesus says, which in the Hebrew alphabet was maybe the yod. It's about the size of an apostrophe, and yet there are over 66,000 of these little pen strokes in the Old Testament original scriptures. Today we might say that we can't forget to dot any I or cross any T. We can't ignore any of God's law. Without keeping the entire law, well, then there is no righteousness. Verse 19. "Anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven." Pure and simple, God hates it when his commandments are broken. Whether someone opens fire on a school full of children or just harbors a grudge in his heart against his neighbor. Whether I tell a big fat lie on my tax forms or a little white lie to my spouse, it's all the same in God's eyes. And the Apostle James explains why. In James chapter 2, he says, "Whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it." So whether I shatter God's law to pieces or just break off the smallest apostrophe, the end result is the same. And the one who teaches others to do the same, Jesus says, to disregard God's commandments, to not take them seriously, well, God says that person will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. Martin Luther understood this to mean that such a person would actually be excluded from heaven. So what are we teaching our children when they hear us cursing and swearing? And what are we teaching co-workers about God's commandments when all we do is smile and nod as someone's name is being dragged through the mud? By our actions, or maybe inaction, are we teaching others to disregard the commandments of our God? And if these words weren't devastating enough, Jesus drops a bombshell on his listeners about the righteousness demanded by the Father. Let's read on in verse 20. "For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven." Now understand how people pictured the Pharisees and teachers of the law. We have a negative connotation of them because we've read what Jesus says about them in Scripture. But in that day, they were held in high regard, because the Pharisees and law teachers didn't just teach the law. They actually wrote the book on it. They even added more rules to what God expected from the Old Testament civil and ceremonial laws, such as things like how many steps a person could take before violating the no work rule on the Sabbath day. In the eyes of the people, these men were the ultimate law keepers. And now Jesus was telling them that their righteousness had to be even greater than the righteousness of these godly men? Well, truth be told, even these models of spirituality couldn't produce the righteousness God demanded. For later in Matthew's gospel, Jesus says this to them, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of dead men's bones and everything unclean." Yikes. If even these men, who on the surface appeared to be the gatekeepers of God's law, were nothing but gross lawbreakers themselves, well, where does that leave the rest of us? When it comes to righteousness, we need to turn our attention away from ourselves. Satan wants us to believe that we can get right with God on our own, and the world around us isn't doing anything to discourage this way of thinking. How else can you explain the reluctance of people today to let the Bible determine the standard of right and wrong? Instead, people want to write their own rules. They want to lessen God's demands, downplay the seriousness of sin, if not dismiss it altogether, and thereby allow people to simply do as they please. But you and I, we don't set the standards. We don't make the rules. God does. Sin is sin, no matter what the world calls it. And sin makes it impossible for us on our own to be right with God. God's law doesn't change, but neither does his gospel. The gospel is the good news that we need, the news that the righteousness we lack has been fulfilled. Jesus Christ came into the world to give us what we couldn't acquire on our own. And he doesn't want us to misunderstand the purpose of his mission. Let's go back to verse 17. "Do not think I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." You know, the religious leaders of the day, they thought that Jesus wasn't taking the law seriously, that he was actually trying to rewrite it as he harshly criticized them for their outward attempts at keeping the law. But Jesus came to do just the opposite, not to destroy the law, but to fulfill it by keeping every iota and every pen stroke perfectly. And he did it all for us. In Romans, it says, "Just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners," that's Adam, "so also through the obedience of the one man, Christ, the many will be made righteous." And that's why we thankfully can refer to Jesus the same way the prophet Jeremiah did, as the Lord, our righteousness. Jesus is our righteousness. You want to find out more about this righteousness? Well, then just simply open your Bibles, because there you'll find, as Paul tells us, that in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, he says in Romans 1, a righteousness that is by faith. God's word tells us about the Savior who fulfilled the law and gave us his righteousness. And that's the wonderful news that gives instant comfort for the guilt-ridden. It provides that the total cure for all wrongs. Yes, Jesus has done what I couldn't do. He made me right with God. And he's done the same for you. The Apostle Paul says, just look to the cross and you'll see how God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. It's on that cross we see the guarantee of a happy ending to this life. We see what's promised next, an eternity with our Lord. But we're not in heaven yet. There's a reason why we're still here on this earth. We're here to flavor the world around us. We're here to enlighten those still in darkness. We're here to share the Savior's righteousness. And that's why Jesus calls us the salt of the earth. Salt was a rather precious commodity in Jesus' day. Before the the days of refrigeration, it was used as a preservative for food. And I've mentioned before that Roman soldiers even were sometimes paid in salt. It was valuable because it could counteract decay. And that's the job Jesus has given us to do as Christians, as salt, to counteract the decay of sin in our world. One of our hymns were reminded, "Change and decay in all around I see." Well, we can't prevent the corruption of sin, but we do have the cure for it. Martin Luther said that our mission as salt is to sting with the law in order to season with the gospel. To do anything less would cause us to lose our saltiness, and we don't want that to happen, because Jesus explains in verse 13, "If the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men." Salt of Jesus' day was impure. It could spoil if exposed to the open air for an extended period of time, and then it would become useless and it would just be thrown out on the path. Well, if the child of God loses his saltiness, if we fail to live up to our God-given purpose, then we too become good for nothing salt. And that's why we can't compromise. We can't soften the message. We can't just dummy down God's law to make it easier to accept. People need to feel that sting, as Luther says, the sting of their sins. They can truly appreciate the sweetness of their Savior. So salt someone. Share with them the righteousness won for them by Christ. And if those listening to Jesus didn't quite grasp the salt illustration, he was kind enough to give them another. Reading on verses 14 and following, Jesus says, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." You know, we're unable to generate light by ourselves, but we don't have to, because Jesus tells us, "I am the light of the world." You and I, we are simply light reflectors. The light of the Savior is the light that we are to reflect for all the world to see. And what a shame it would be to cover up that light. What a shame it would be if we didn't share the righteousness won by our Savior and the joy that comes with it. See, Christ doesn't light us up just for us to go into hiding like monks in a monastery. No, he puts us, as he says, on a stand for others to see, to let our light shine, to let others notice our good deeds, not for personal praise or future reward, but again, so that others might praise your Father in heaven. God sets us up. He lights us up to show others the joy of being right with him. He makes us light to share his light in a world of darkness. And so that's our assignment as Christians. Sometimes we can be better lights, though, with our deeds than with our creeds. Someone said that the world may care little for our words, but always has a sharp eye on our works. So here's the question: what have you been showing the world lately? Have you been sharing the righteousness of Christ? Has anyone been influenced positively by your actions as a Christian? Do people regularly see your car pulling out of the driveway every Sunday morning, or do they only witness the occasional pilgrimage to God's house? When people ask you what you did over the weekend, have you learned to mention part of your weekend was spent Sunday morning in God's house? Do your coworkers see you putting in an honest day work without complaining? At school, do your friends know you disapprove of cheating and foul language, or do they see you just joining in with the rest of the crowd? Can others tell that you honor the sixth commandment with those you're dating? Or are you guilty of taking part in blessings God has reserved only for marriage? In general, do people see you rejoicing and being thankful for the righteousness he's given you in Christ? Do they see what a difference the Savior has made in your life? Do they see what a blessing it is being right with God. If you're already helping others see how they can be right with God, keep up the good work. If not, what are you waiting for? Don't keep your Savior a secret. You're salt, you're meant to flavor, you're lights, you're meant to shine. Share the righteousness demanded by God, but fulfilled by the Savior. Everyone needs to hear the news. The news that they don't have to get right with God, because Jesus has already made them right. Amen. The peace of God that transcends all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, you delight to loose the bonds of wickedness and undo the straps of the heavy yoke, that, freed from sin's bondage, we may gladly receive your blessings. Preserve us from the lie that you are a cruel oppressor, and give us thankful hearts to rejoice that you are the giver of all good gifts. Merciful God, preserve your church by your life-giving word. Open the lips of pastors to declare your just decrees, and store them up in the hearts of your people, that we may delight in your promises and abound in good works. O Lord, give wisdom and courage to parents as they teach their children your ways. Make our homes havens of peace in a quarrelsome, self-seeking world. Heavenly Father, you declare that a young man may keep his way pure by guarding it according to your word. Protect children and youth against the siren calls of the devil, the world, and their own sinful nature. Grant delight in your testimonies as much as in all riches. Almighty God, according to your wisdom, you establish rulers of this age for a time. Remember Joseph Biden, our President Laura Kelly, our governor, and all those you have placed in authority, that they might fulfill their duties with wisdom. Holy Father, cause healing to spring up speedily for the sake of your Son. So have mercy upon those who suffer afflictions of sin in mind and body. Where you permit trial to remain, preserve your people in faith until the day when your light breaks forth like the dawn. Lord God, Heavenly Father, send forth your Holy Spirit, that delivered from the spirit of this world, we may hold fast in faith to what you freely give us, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, in whose name we are also privileged to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Blessings to you this day, this coming week, and beyond. Again, if there's anything with which I can be of service to you, then don't hesitate to ask. Remember, the Lord is our righteousness. Remember to rejoice in that, to share that message with others, and to know that God will be with you as you do so. Blessings on your week. God willing, we'll see you again. Take care. Bye-bye.